Okay, welcome back.
This is the start of video number 12, which is the integumentary system, or the skin, okay? Now, depending on your facility policy, you may or may not do, you know, simple dressing changes, okay? But if you do, this is what we're going to be talking about, you know, as part of this session here. But just to basically kind of get started and talk about some of the key terms when it comes to the skin and a little bit of refresher on the skin system, a histamine or antihistamine is a drug that simply works against the effects of histamine. Histamine gets into your body through different environmental sources, your body reacts to it, while the antihistamine calms your reaction to that stimuli, that histamine. So maybe you don't itch so bad, your eyes don't run so bad, your nose doesn't water so bad. Anti-inflammatories are again used for the skin in a cream form, drugs that suppress inflammation. A lot of your medications, because a lot of times we itch with our skin, we scratch and scratch and scratch and itch. An antipyretic is the classification for that drug that relieves itching. Of course, an antiseptic is an agent that inhibits the growth of microorganisms. So that would be something that we would be cleaning the skin with. Contact dermatitis, of course, is just that. A person comes into contact with an irritating substance and touches on their skin, of course, and the reaction is some type of rash or something like that. The layers of the skin, you know, what is on top is, of course, the epidermis, right beneath that is the dermis, and then of course beneath that is the sub-Q or the subcutaneous level. And again, going back to the dermatogenic patch, I can't stress enough that that is where that patch needs to be placed to work effectively to control pain. So sometimes I know it's a challenge finding a spot to put them on, but you know, a lot of times we can't. Back of the arm, the love handles here, maybe a thigh like that. Ecchymosis, of course, is a discoloration of the skin. It's usually caused by leaking blood into the subcutaneous tissue. You know, anytime the skin is hit or hurt or ruptured or whatever, you know, blood vessels break, they leak into the skin, and it causes this ecchymosis, this discoloration, we call it a bruise or whatever. And it's always a sign that blood vessels are broken. Now, here again, talking about Coumadin and other blood thinners, this could be our initial sign that the blood is too thin. And of course, if the blood and blood vessels get too thin, we're talking possibly a break of an important blood vessel in the heart, or a break of a vessel in the brain. Edema, of course, that is basically swelling, okay? And there's four stages to edema. We're going to talk about it here in just a moment. And one of the things about edema is it's usually pointing or giving us information that there's an issue either with the heart or an issue with the kidneys. Something of the function of either one of those or both of those organs is having distress. Erythema is just reddening of the skin. It's caused by dilation of superficial capillaries. Hives, of course, you know, are lesions on the skin. A lot of time these hives, these lesions, it's exposure to an allergen, and it can be our warning that somebody is allergic to a medication, especially an antibiotic. And they'll break out with hives or rash, usually on the trunk, upper trunk first, chest or back. If it goes unheeded and the medicine continues to be given, and nobody has caught the fact that they are breaking out with these hives, the hives could internalize. In other words, and where it seems that they internalize is the throat, and to make a long story short, what they can do is crush the trachea. And of course, that's gonna, you know, they'll first start out with a wheeze when they're breathing as the trachea starts to narrow, and then as it gets worse, it could totally clamp, close off the trachea. Inflammation, of course, is a response of body tissue to an irritant where it swells. Integumentary system, well, that's what we're talking about. The integumentary system is the medical terminology word for basically skin. Okay, so like I said, we have our three layers of skin, our epidermis on top, then our dermis, and then our subcutaneous, you know, below it. Now, when we kind of talk about the skin, like I said, you know, pruritus means itching, erythema means reddening, and then edema means swelling. And like I said, there are basically four stages to edema. Stage one is called pedal or pedal edema, you know, kind of like a crick or creek kind of a thing, however, you know, you're used to saying it. But what'll happen in stage one is a little bit of fluid will accumulate on top of the person's foot. As they go on to stage two, not only the fluid will be on top of their foot, but it'll be like if this is the leg and this is the foot, it'll be around the ankle. And there'll be so much fluid in there, you can press your finger to it, and you'll actually leave an indentation mark or a pit mark. So that's how stage two edema got called pitting edema. Now in stage three, it'll start to back up the leg and come up the leg, and you know, and it'll engorge the tissue, the skin so much, it'll fill it where it'll tighten, and the whole bottom part of the leg could get very hard. And that's what's nicknamed brawny edema. And then in stage four, the tissue will again get so engorged with fluid that is backing up. See, because where this is all going is back toward the heart. See, it starts at the foot, come up the leg, so it's backing up further and further, and it backs up further and further. We're talking about the fluid building up in the heart. So, but right now we're on stage four, and it's, like I said, the tissue will be so engorged with fluid, it'll start splitting the skin, or the fluid will start to leak out the skin. Because we know fluid from the inside of our body comes out through the pores of our skin. We know about perspiration, we call it sweat. Well, the same thing with our interstitial fluid, it can also come out through the pores of our leg, and it kind of skin kind of weeps or cries, and that's how stage four edema got called weeping edema. Now, when this happens, pruritus will be, or skin itching will be a major issue for your folks, because the crystals will dry on the skin, and that will cause a lot of itching of the legs. So an antipyretic is probably going to be what's needed for them. Benadryl is a favorite. It's inexpensive, and it does help with a lot of the itching. It also can relax a person, and some people use it for a sleeping pill. So if you have somebody that's up ad lib, you know, watch their balance. You know, warn them not to, if they're lying down or sitting down, not to jump up immediately and start to walk. You know, that orthostatic hypotension, you know, where a person stands too much, the blood pressure drops suddenly, not enough blood to the brain, they get dizzy, they fall. And of course, we don't want our residents getting broken hips, because it's just not that unusual for a person to fall with this orthostatic hypotension. But because it'll leave the crystals when it goes into weepy edema or stage four on the leg. So they're going to need probably some type of antipyretic, and just plain old good mild soap washing off the legs too will also help. Because like I said, where the fluid is backing up to is, you know, toward the heart. And it will back up so much, it will a lot of times start to fill the lungs or start to fill around the heart. Either one of those, you know, the pulmonary edema, the cardiac edema, are very severe, very, very major issues. Some of our major skin disorders, of course, are contact dermatitis, where they touch something, and it's not that unusual for, you know, residents to go out with their families, especially, you know, for picnics and birthdays, and the little one brings grandma or grandpa this really nice plant they picked, and it's poison ivy or something like that. So they can come into contact with things like that. Psoriasis, you'll hear people call the heartbreak of psoriasis. It's where the elbow gets incredibly dry, and it'll get so dry, you'll see like silvery scales on the elbow, you know, and of course it itches and they're scratching it, and of course when they scratch it so much, they bleed. Burns, of course, are other major skin issues. One of our biggest ones that we worry about the most are basically pressure sores, bed sores, decubitus ulcers, call them whatever you want. But they're caused by pressure. Because see, what pressure does is stop the flow of blood to that part of the body that's under pressure. If this were a glass table and you were here right now, and I put my hand down like this, and you looked, you know, got on your hands and knees, and like I said, this were a glass table, and you could look up at my hand that is being pushed down on the table here real hard, you would see the bottom of my hand turning white. Why? It's a lack of blood flow, and that's what exactly causes a pressure sore. Now, there are four stages, levels of decubitus ulcers, and this is a generalization, okay, but it's one of the best ways that I know how to explain what a stage one is, a two, a three, and a four. In a stage one, the hip, say for instance, or the shoulder, it'll be a like a sunburn. It'll be a red area that looks like they got a sunburn there. A stage two, you will see blisters. It doesn't matter if they're broken or intact, can be either one. But a stage two will have blisters. Now, in a stage three, what'll happen is, now here's where it starts to go deep into the tissue. And in a stage three, it'll be so deep that you can visually look into the crater or the hole and see subcutaneous tissue. And this is where I said earlier our three levels of the skin, epidermis, on top, dermis, and then sub-Q. So you can actually see visually subcutaneous tissue. Now, you may have had a steak before or something like that. Around the edges is the fat, you know, and you cut it off maybe, you didn't need it, you know. That's subcutaneous tissue, you know. So when you look at this subcutaneous tissue in the human, it'll kind of be marbly yellow if it's still healthy, you'll basically see that. Now, a stage four goes even deeper, and a stage four will be so deep when you look into the hole or the crater, you will visually see muscle or bone. So that's getting pretty deep with the stage four. And of course, we don't, you know, want to see any of those. Now, in a stage one, you know, a lot of people, like I said, it'll look like a sunburn here in the shoulder. A lot of people will rub that area. Don't. Rub around the area, but don't rub on the red area. The tissue is already damaged. The rubbing will create this friction or shearing that you've heard so much about, why we we float the heels and why we don't drag people up in bed, why we lift them with a draw sheet off the bed, bring them up, sit them down gently. We don't drag people because of shearing friction. Well, the same thing here, rubbing on this red area will further damage the tissue. You want to rub around it. Now, if you're rubbing around it and this red area pinks back up and equalizes with the color of the rest of the skin around the shoulder, you've just done a wonderful thing. You have stopped a stage one decay. If it doesn't disappear with your gentle massage around it for 15, 20 seconds, you've got a stage one decay. Team leader needs to be contacted because there are skin ointments that can start to be put on there to strengthen the integrity of the skin and help it not go on to a stage two. Skin infections happen a lot of times. When we talk about infections, especially in the elderly, what I was taught at school is what was called the three W's: wind, water, wound. Wind, of course, when you think of wind, you think of air. Well, what do we have as air? Is our lungs. That's one of our big sources of infections, respiratory infections. Water, well, when you think of water, you think of urine. So urinary tract infections. And then wound is basically skin. So in other words, these are a lot of the three places. Now, yes, there's always going to be the eye infection, ear infection, throat infection, whatever. But most of your infections you're going to see are going to be one of these three W's: wind, water, wound. And especially with wound, see, because our skin is like our armor. It's our first line of defense. And if the skin is tore, there is a portal of entry for pathogens to basically enter in to make a person sick. So, In our topical meds, we have protective meds. These are meds that cover, they cool, they have a soothing effect on inflamed skin. We have antipyretics that relieve itching that's caused by inflammation. We have some topical corticosteroids that are also do have an anti-inflammatory effect. We have other topical meds that are antiseptics that inhibit the growth of microorganisms on the skin when we clean them. And then, of course, we have some other meds that are called topical anesthetics. Because a lot of times, the elderly will get skin tears, and they hurt pretty bad, you know. And some of these topical anesthetics can help them control their pain in the local area here. There's been several times when I've talked to the doctors and I've asked them, viscous xylocaine, okay, if you've gone to the dentist, they've injected your jaw to drill or pull, you know, more than likely they were using one of the canes, okay, lidocaine, one of the canes to numb your jaw to do the work. Well, there's a gel kind of an ointment called viscous xylocaine that is really thick. It comes in a little squirt bottle, but it numbs the skin. Some people I know have had really bad toothaches. They put a few drops on a Q-tip and hold the Q-tip against where the tooth was hurting real bad to numb the tooth or whatever. But here for the skin, I've asked the docs, can we compound a little bit here? Can we add two together? So I know I'm going to be putting on an antibiotic ointment if they've got a skin tear. Can I mix in a little bit of viscous xylocaine? And if it's compatible, if the pharmacy tells me, yes, you can mix viscous xylocaine with this particular antibiotic ointment, you know, it does help their pain a lot. Because with a skin tear, blood vessels are exposed, nerves are exposed, and that's a lot of times why people hurt real bad. Now, when we talk about skin, we have to talk about transdermal delivery system of medicine, the skin patches. Now, When you take your skin patch out, it's going to have a major backing, and you're of course going to peel that off, okay? Now, there's another thin layer that holds that medicine in the pad so it doesn't leak and spill out. And it's a thermal pad, it's a melt-away pad. So when you put your patches on your folks, you've got to hold your hand like this for 1 minute on whatever area you put it on, because the heat from your hand, the heat from their body, is going to help this melt-away seal do just that, melt away. And now the pad is able to start slowly dispersing the medicine out. Placement in a lot of these, you know, medication patches are really important. The biggest one, again, is Duragesic. It has to be over fat. Monitor the residents for the patches working. Always when you're putting on a patch, remember there's another one already there from the other day or something like that. So take your old one off first before you put the new one on. That way you're not so likelihood to get into overdose. Wear gloves when you put these patches on. These patches are meant to absorb through the skin. Some of them can absorb through the skin of your hands. And, you know, if you're allergic to it, who knows what may happen. Or some of the medicine gets into you, and then basically what can happen is you can suffer the effects of the medicine. I did one time see a nurse faint because she got some nitrobid ointment. It's an ointment that's coming back. It's nitroglycerin, but it's in an ointment form. It's like in a tube of toothpaste. You have a special wax paper with a ruler on it, and you simply squirt out whatever the doctor ordered, a half inch, an inch, or whatever, and you put it on the person. A lot of times they don't stick real well, so you have to corner down the edges with paper tape. But she got some of that nitrobid ointment on her. It absorbed enough through her fingers, and she fainted. Her blood pressure got so low, bless her heart, she fainted walking down the hall and basically fell. Now, simple dressing changes, you know, you may or may not, you know, according to facility policy, do this dressing changes for, you know, like skin tears and stuff. Now, you've changed briefs before and pull-ups before. You know the four-step order. You know, you take off the old dressing, you clean them up, you more than likely are going to put on some type of skin protective ointment, and then you put the new brief on. Well, for a dressing, it's the exact same way. You take off the old dressing, you clean it, dab it. Don't rub it, but dab it. Because the rubbing, again, we have a friction problem. We could further damage the skin. So you dab it with whatever.